Thank you very much, Olivia. And first of all, I would like to thank all the people in the scientific committee for inviting me, and all the people in the organizing committee for their excellent work in organizing this conference in such a beautiful location. And last but not least, I would like to thank all of you that is here to listen to me. I will talk about a proposal which consists in trying to generalize the notion of elementary topos in such a way that the structure of this generalized elementary topos includes, as example, category of sets formalized in predicative foundations. So the general broad aim is to extend the topos theory to predicative mathematics. Olivia in her talk already said that topos can be thought as spaces to unify mathematics. The long-term aim here is to include in the space of topos. To include in the landscape of topos also universes of sets formalized in predicative mathematics. And our aim, more specifically, is to give, to generalize the axiomatization of an elementary topos. As I said, to include universes of sets in predicative foundations, and this line of research has been already started has already been explored, let's say, by some prominent scholars, and my work is indeed inspired by the work started by Eike Murdich and Erik Palgren. The paper well-founded trees in categories, and it was later developed in another paper by Murdich and Vandenberg, and which is in turn inspired by old work by Eike Murdich with Andrea Joyal, which is algebraic set theory. But my work is a contribution to this line of research. It is also carried on by other mostly constructive predicative mathematicians, including those that are working on homotopy type theory. We have heard some talks the first day of the conference, in particular by the people working in constructive type theory. Formalized constructive type theory introduced by Martin Löf. And my focus is to propose an axiomatization which is very natural and which will focus on the notion of power object, of power object, while the work by Murdich and Palgren and Benno is focusing on defining as a predicative topos the structure, the inductive structure of a topos, and they are motivated by the fact that they want to axiomatize the category of sets in Martin Löf type theory. In the same, they are doing this in the same spirit of Billovier, when he wanted at the beginning to give the notion of an elementary topo to axiomatize the structure of the category of classical sets and then of Grothendieck topos. My focus is not, I'm not concentrating on trying to axiomatize a specific category of set like the Martin Löf type theory. I'm focusing on the notion of elementary topos, on the axiomatization of elementary topos, And I'm trying to generalize it in order to include various kinds of categorical structures formalized in predicative mathematics, but focusing on the logical part of the elementary topos. No worried at the moment about the inductive structures of that, like well-founded sets. I'm trying to do this because in my mind, in the long term, there is behind another generalization, which is the generalization of the notion of quasi-topos, which for my purposes will be very, very useful. As I will try to give an try to suggest it at the end of my talk. So, I will spend some time motivating the background behind the predicative constructive foundation. Then I will propose a predicative generalization of the notion of elementary topos, and then I will end, hopefully, with showing you some examples of this generalized elementary topos by showing you that category of sets formalized in most of the predicative constructive foundation available can be built. So, the specific aim I want to reach is the following. I want to define a predicatively generalized elementary topos such a way that it has an internal language which is predicative in the sense of Poincaré and Russell and also Martin Löf. In such a date that if we add to this to the generic internal language, which is the internal language of the initial generalized elementary topos, if we add to this generic internal language a resizing rule, a sort of resizing rule like the one by Wojvoski, which resembles the axiom of reducibility by Russell, then I get a theory, a calculus equivalent to that of an elementary topos. And of course, then I have to take care of to make an axiomatization which include the examples, relevant examples of category of sets and near head classes, and we'll see why, that are formalized in the most relevant predicative foundation of mathematics, constructive ones actually, available today. Okay. So, first, we need to review briefly that why the generic internal language of elementary topos is impredicative in the sense of Russell Poincaré. We need to, I hope that you know what is an internal language, and pass to say that regarding elementary topos, I also built an internal language, which is different to the one that Professor Bosseau taught to you the first day, the second day, I think, of the summer school, or the school done in the previous days. And why the well-known language, internal language of elementary topos is formulated as a many-sorted intuitionistic logic, the internal language I developed back in my PhD thesis a long time ago is a dependent type theory alla Martin Löf. And this was a sort of inspiring to me because through the language and study the language that I got the idea to get the generalized predicative version. Basically, we can see that the difference between the well-known internal language of Topoli, which is the Penabou-Mitchell language, is that the one defined by Penabou has one sort, which is given by types, so many sorts because we have given by simple types. And these are not dependent. And then there is a different notion of a different syntactic concept, which is that of proposition. And proposition is defined as terms of the type of the subobject classifier. Instead, in the language I developed as a dependent type theory with dependent types, propositions are not defined as terms of the classifier, but are defined as subobjects, let's say. So are defined as what I call monotypes. And then you can see in the language the classification, as you see in the definition of the category. So the classification is not implicit, it's explicit here. And you can see that the classification of this proposition through the classifier, which is the type, which is denoted by O1, and which classify the proposition up to equiprobability. And the outcome is that the syntactic category is different. While to build a syntactic category with a Boole-Mitchell language, you have to go through, you cannot put types here. You need to put subsets of types. And you need to take functional relations as morphism. In the internal language I developed, you can build the syntactic categories when you do a syntactic category or type theory. You do the closed types and the type terms. And then I define the proposition as a type, which is equipped with at most one proof by using the I was working in a dependent type theory a la Martin Löf, and I take as a basic type theory, I take as internal language of the topos, the first order fragment of Martin Löf type theory, plus where there is this equality predicate, and I define a proposition by this condition. A predicate is just a more generic dependent type where is a value of each x is a proposition, so a propositional function. And so we just say that a predicate is a monodependent type if satisfied this condition, so its value is a proposition, so it's equipped to the most one proof. This notion was taken as it is, not as it is, in a similar way by Wojbowski. When Wojbowski defined his notion of proposition in his univalent foundation, he just take this, but replace the equality here, which is extensional because I put it in an extensional framework with identity. So, in this respect, we see that the type theory of topos has built on a first order language where I have an axiomatization of subobject through this condition. And then you can see that the source of the impredicativity in the internal language is due to the fact that given any proposition, quantifier, depending on a type A and is power object, we can form a subset of the power object where we define extension, let's say, of a proposition where the quantification can be given on the power set itself. So here what you have? You have that you define a subset into a power object which is defined by proposition which is closed under quantification overall subset. But this is forbidden by the notion of predicate definition by Russell Poincaré, because he says, they say that whatever involves an apparent variable but must be among the possible values of that variable. Very simple. So what we have to do, we have to discharge this. And first, before doing this and making predicate, I want to give some motivation. We do this. Why we want to do this predicative definition? And as I said, I start from the definition of elementary topos and try to make it predicative as it is, without any goal, okay? And the idea, the aim, or the my motivation, is that by doing this, I want to analyze in a final way the mathematical concept and proofs in the topos, in the elementary topos. Following the spirit of reverse mathematics by Friedman. And if we do this, Friedman was doing reverse mathematics for classical mathematics. Here, what we do here is to making the idea is to give this notion of predicative topos to get the same constructive reverse mathematics in topos theory, where you have a benefit in addition to formalizing concepts and theorems in classical mathematics. The formalization of theorems and proofs in a constructive foundation gives an extra benefit the fact that the proofs can be taught as programs. So while you do mathematics, you compute by building when you write function, this has to be shown to be computable. So you gain a computability aspect of your proofs, which are not visible when you do abstract mathematics. Basically, thinking a moment on the essence of constructive mathematics, most of people say that constructive mathematics is simply mathematics done in intuitionistic logic. But this is not actually the real essence of constructive mathematics. This is, a pragmatic definition. But what is the essence of constructive mathematics, which is the real motivation to do it, is that constructive mathematics is abstract mathematics, which has for free, without effort, attached to it computational contents. So while you do constructive mathematics, you do implicitly computational mathematics. But this is possible only if your mathematics is formalized in the foundation with admitted a computational interpretation, where constructive proofs are seen as programs and function between natural numbers are seen as computable. Then, the problem is that while for classical mathematics there is one standard predicative foundation, ZFC, for constructive mathematics the notion of constructivity is not unique. There are different notions of constructivity, thinking always of the constructive interpretation. There is no standard foundation, but there is a plurality of foundations. And so, when we think of saying we want to assumatize definition topos, say we want to generalize the definition of elementary topos to include category of sets formalized in constructive foundation, there are many. And one can choose, but there are many. And I don't list here all of them, but what I want to stress with the fact there are many is that already in 2005 with Giovanni Sambin we thought that the plurality of constructive foundations is a rich aspect of constructive mathematics, not a weak aspect. In order to make profit of this, the idea was to think not a full-scale foundation which covers everything, as in classical mathematics, you have one standard foundation where everything can be deformalized. No, we thought to go in the opposite direction, giving the plurality of foundations, everyone comes with his best choice. Even toposes are one of a choice. Elementary toposes, as universal sets, are one possible choice. Then we thought to ask what is the common core. Why we do this? Because we wanted to unify, let's say, the landscape of foundation, not by building a large one, but being minimalist. So try to take a common core among the foundations in order to analyze the common aspect of the various proofs, if there are, and try to see a theorem like Tikhonov theorem, proved in Toposis, proof in type theory, proof in CCF, or Axel, try to see if there is a proof which is common to everyone, the essence. So the essence of this proofs is here underlined, or is captured by reducing to the minimum the assumptions, and try to analyze it with the weakest possible formal system, which is not the empty formal system, but it contains arithmetics, and is thought to be a common core, so it's the maximum about the various plural foundation, which I forgot to say, are incompatible. So there is not possible to make, for some foundations, not possible to merge them, like intentional type theory, there is a form of axiom of choice, which is not obvious how to translate in topos theory, where an axiom of choice would make the internal logic classical. So with Giovanni Stambin, we thought to build a minimal foundation, to work with the minimal foundation, and I say the minimal foundation because the focus will be then to try to assumatize or to try to get to generalize the notion of elementary topos so that I can assumatize the category of sets and classes in this minimum core. So that's why I'm interested, and I'm not interested in one particular, step theory. Before doing this, with Giovanni Stambin, we thought that we should go back and try to think what is a foundation of mathematics, because there are many foundations, different kind and type theory, category theory, set theory, with different aspects, with different benefits, and so. And so we thought to put the different benefits or good characteristics of all foundations in one framework. And so what we saw, we thought that a constructive foundation should be at least be a two-level foundation with an extra level. And what are the foundations, what are these levels? We should have an extensional level to be the level where the mathematician formalizes this theorem. This level has to be an extensional language, close to the language of everyday mathematics, but this should admit an interpretation into a quotient completion of an intentional level, which is meant to be a type theory, an intentional type theory, with all the good features, like the decidability of type checking, and normalization of proofs, consistency proofs, that are very useful to build a proof assistant. So type theory, one of the things that attracted also Vladimir Voivodsky was that the proof assistant Koch was using was based on a type theory, not on a set theory. And so, because there are deep motivation for doing that, and so what we thinking of the various aspects of the foundation, we thought to put together the intentional aspects of a type theory, which are very, very far from the language used in everyday practice, but to merge them by thinking the extensional level, the extensional language, as a language interpreted in a quotient completion of the intentional one. What does the quotient completion add? The extensional feature that the intentional one does not have because of computer science, let's say, requirement to build the proof assistant. And then there is a third level, which is a realizability level, where we make explicit the computational contents of the proofs, which is not explicit when you write down, by building a model which usually is a realizability topos, because but it is realizability topos which cannot be taken to be the internal language cannot be, in our opinion, cannot be taken to be the base of our foundation, because it validates computational axiom like formature thesis, a form of axiom of choice, which is not compatible with our foundation. So it is an extra level, it is a property. So by doing this, we built a two-level foundation, which is whose intentional level is a predicative version of the calculus construction behind the COC. Here I took without inductive types, inductive definition, because I'm interested in the minimalist core, which is the mastery of the logic. And then the extensional level is a local set theory, exactly as that of the internal language of a topos. But actually, at the end of this talk, but I anticipate here, is the internal language of what I think is, what I propose is, a predicatively generalized quasi arithmetic quasi topos. So the quasi topos has a difference between the topos because the classification of the monomorphism is not the classifier is restricted to strong monomorphisms. So in the strong monomorphism are defined as orthogonal to happy, and the happy are usually linked to surjective happy, so they are linked to a logic. You have a factorization system, so you have a logic underline which you can choose and which is more flexible than that of elementary topos, it's more general. And this is behind the design of this extensional level. So topos theory is always with me since the beginning. The internal language is always in my thought. And so we built a minimalist foundation, and this can be shown to be the common core of all this. Actually, the extensional level will be compared with this with the extensional foundation, the intentional one with the intentional foundation. And the comparison is has to be specified carefully. And this is. So what I want to say now that foundations, minimalist foundation, there are some features shared by other foundations. Like, for example, it constructed the Mellow-Frank set theory, which is axiomatic set theory built by Peter Axel, but in a predicative form. And it has a power object of a class, which is not a set, but a class. And the subset are not generic subset as usual. They are subset of which are extensions. They are subset of a set, which are extension of a formula phi of x, which has bounded quantifier. This is, so we have this picture, which is we need to keep in mind. We can see that in Axel set theory we have four entities. We don't just have sets and propositions as usually in a topos or in a usual foundation, but we have four entities: proposition, classes, sets, and a small proposition. And when we take a set, the power object of this and when we take a set, we define as a subset that will be classified by the power object as those determined by the small proposition, not by a proposition. But then the classifier will be living in a class. It will be a class. The same feature is in the minimalist foundation, where we have a small proposition, sets, proposition, collection. This is different from Martin Löf type theory. I go back, peculiarity of Martin Löf type theory. This is why the notion of the structures used by Benno, Van den Berg, Murdig, and Erik Palgren is different from my assumatization, because the focus is on a foundation where this power object is not there. You don't see the power object in the Martin Löf type theory. Why? Because instead you have a cumulative hierarchy of sets. an infinite cumulative hierarchy of sets, and you can mimic the mathematics done predicatively by choosing the right universe, then jump in the next one when you want to do something like some construction like the one you would do it with the power object. But there is no power object. And the focus instead, which is reflected by the notion of particle topos as a locally Cartesian closed pre-topos with well-founded trees, is reflected the fact that the focus is on the inductive generation of all the sets, including the universe. But in the sense that all the entities which are but predicatively acceptable by according to Per Martin Löf are those that can be inductively generated. Means that they can be equipped with an induction principle which helps you to prove the property on the entity by induction, and the recursion operator, which allows you to define functions by recursions from the object you are describing to any other. But not necessarily the induction principle is put down the theory like for the universes, because if you put down the induction principle, you give and you make an extension, you have to change it. So it's sensitive to the extension, the induction principle of the universes. And so it's not put there. But so since there is not a power object, this is reflected in the notion of predicative, let's say predicative topos, given the work by Benno, Van den Berg, Ike Murdek, and Erik Palgre. I'm not focusing on that, but I will focus. I will focus on the other. On the power object. And I want to stress that homotopy type theory follows as an extension of Martin Löf type theory. Actually, Wojvoski put the resizing rule to get back the structure of topos that you can also take out. But the nice thing of the really nice thing of the homotopy type theory, and we will see in the example, is that by the use of the univalence action, we can have extensional features which were not available before in Martin Löf type theory. And with the addition of high-order eigeninductive quotients, the two levels which I was used, intentional and extensional, to formalize mathematics here, comes into the same level. The only what is missed there is the compatibility with other foundations, predicative classical foundation, which the minimalist foundation instead the minimalist foundation will keep this compatibility. And so in the homotopy theory, the two levels are in into one. So now I start to give the definition of predicative generalized elementary topos by keeping in mind that I want to take in account the four entities. So I don't follow Martin Löf in this respect. I follow Axel set theory, and I follow the usual practice of mathematics to have a language where you can write. You can write what? You can write, for example, the notion of locale. This is important because I was doing constructive topology with the people in Padova, and there we used the somatization of Martin Löf, well, of a cover, which is like which is very close to the, which is represented by closure operator, like Lovier-Tierney topology. On a base opens, where you have a base of opens, which is a set. But then the closure operator is given on the subsets of the set, and on the power object, which is not a set. And there is no example of a set which is complete in a constructive foundation, as in predicative constructive foundation. So you are bound to use to size the issue. The problem is that we want to have this operator not at the meta logic as Martin Löf does, but within our foundation. And we want to define not only inductively generated format topology, because we are not restricted to inductively generated topologies. We want to speak also of the Dedekind-McNeill topology, which predicatively is not inductively generated. So we want to keep the two, we want to have the power object. So that's why I'm going to define the notion of generalized predicative topos. By using what? By using vibration. By vibration, I mean the Faber category, so a functor between two categories, and don't bother, I'm not worried about size issue because they can be put the definition can be put correctly in the right meta theory, meta set, in the right set theory used to formalize these notions. But I don't specify it now. And so the Faber category is a usual notion where you have that for any object, any morphisms from any object of the S on the category, the domain of the fibration, to any, any morphism in the base category from an object to a P of the value of the fibration on any object from S, you can lift it to a Cartesian error. And I will speak of the codomain fibration in the next, mostly, also only, almost, which is assigned to the category of finite limits on the error category. So I give for granted this. And then what I say, that a predicatively generalized, sorry, for elementary topos is given by a fibration, which is on a category, the base category has finite limits, so it's tended to be the category of collection. Then I ask that this category has a structure of Lovier rapid octave for Stordal without for Stordal rapid octave with for all the interpretation of for Stordal logic. This structure has to be validated in the subobject doctrine associated to the category C of collection. So you have a logic to speak of collection of classes. Then what we have, that the fibration PS is actually the restriction of the codomain fibration on this category S, which is a full self-fibration, the codomain fibration on C, which represents the family of set index over classes or collection, as you want to say. Collection and classes are interchangeable for me now, interchangeable names. And so the idea is that we have a fibration of which speaks of index set and the family of set index of a collection as a sub-fibration of the families of collections. Then for each fiber, for each object, for each collection, the fibers of family of sets is as now, I copy and paste the definition by Murdick and Pygram, locally Cartesian closed p-topos. I don't put well-founded here because I'm not interested in the deductive structure now. Then any morphisms in the base, when lifted to the fibers, has to preserve the structures, of course. And then for every object, the embedding of the fiber on a collection of family of sets into the ambient category of fibers of A, of family of collection, has to preserve the LCC topo structure. Actually, this is not a LCC topo structure, but we'll eradicate the structure from this, so it will be closed under LCC topo structure when restricted to family of sets. Finally, now the real point, new, say, is that, not new, but just that I want to focus on it. that is an object which is a classifier of what? Not of the subobject functor of collection, because this would make impredicative the whole structure. the internal language would be in predicative. No, it has to be classifier of the subobject functor restricted to family of sets. So the sub is the full subcategory of the collection of subobject which are represented by object in S. And then, no, it's not finished. With this, we just have P of 1, omega. We need to add the power of A, the power of any set. So I just add it. So I add that for any object and for any family of sets, of any object in S, do you hear me? There is an exponentiable object in the fiber of C, of array in the category, the square category of C, such arrow category, sorry, of C, which is an exponentiable of object of alpha. So that's all. And what happens is that now we can give examples. And in the examples, since this, after all, is just a sub-fabrication of the codomain fabrication, I only specify the category of collection and specify the category S, which is a subcategory of the arrow category of correction, and full subcategory. So I just specify the object of S, because it's a full subcategory of the arrow category of the category of collection. And then the rest of the structure is given, is determined by this. And so the first thing, which is important, is that an elementary topos is an instance of a predicative generalized elementary topos. Because I take the category of S, sorry, sorry, this should be S, C arrow, which is the codomain fabrication, so the predicative topos as the category S to be the category of arrow. Here there is a mistake, there should be C arrow, arrow, T arrow. And now, what I want to stress, okay, that the internal language can be given, and this extension of first order extensional Martin-Löf type theory, like in the internal language of the topos, but now we are forced to put four entities because of the classification. So we have to put a small proposition, proposition, set, and collection. And of course, here collection are closed under the types of LX category, then are closed under power and power collection of a set. Proposition are defined as at most singleton collection, following the definition I gave at the beginning of proposition, is the same applied here. Then sets will be another entity, another source, which will be a subsource of collection. And this will be closed under the constructor analysis pretopos. A small proposition are defined, is a derived sort. Actually, the type theory will have three sorts. This will be a defined sort. It will be defined as sets which are at most singleton. And this type theory, I don't see it, I don't specify it, but in one of the slides which I didn't show you, there was the list of many categorical structures on which I defined internal type theory as a dependent type theory. As that work that I did in my PhD thesis is now useful to get the internal language of this notion. I just use that. Then, nice thing, which I like, is the following, that if you add this rule, that a proposition is a small proposition, that you get a calculus, the one I showed you, which is equivalent to the internal language of a topos. So I already have the proof I told you at the beginning. And now I give you some examples. I give you four examples very quickly with the most of the known relevant foundation. The first example is the one with Axel. Let's just see what happens with Axel set theory. With Axel set theory, I take as a category of collection the syntactic category of CCF definable classes and functional relation. Definable classes means classes defined by a formula. So in the language of Excel, you have a first order logic with the axiom for set, the variable are meant to vary on sets, and then you can define this. And the object of S, remember that there had to be arrows in C arrow, and they have projection of disjoint sum of index family of sets, denoted with projection. Very simple. The omega is simply this formula, which is a formula. The set of including in the 2-1, a power class of subs of the set exists. This is the same as in Gödel-Bernays theory, where you have a power classifier, power object. And with the notion of a generalized predicative generalized elementary tuple, you can be the example also with ZFC by taking C the category of classes. So they are also very, let's say, not counterintuitive in a sense, examples, but because this structure is very general. And then another very nice example, which I like, is the one with the homotopy type theory, so the extension of Martin Leaf type theory, with the Voivodsky univalence axiom, plus with at least one universe, but it has to be closed under quotient, otherwise I don't make the structure I want. And Simon Huber told me that in his paper he has a consistency of this extension, where you include in the universe the codes of the quotient on the sets. I just need the quotients on sets of equivalence relation represented by proposition in the first universe. And of course the sets have to be on the support of the quotients has to be also in the first universe. And by making this assumption, I make an example of my generalized notion of elementary totals by taking this object, Voivodsky sets, not types. I'm not formalizing the whole category of types as an infinite topos. No, not my aim. My aim is to, within the vast structure of this, to select my notion of generalized elementary topos with object are Voivodsky sets, morphisms are type terms, and propositional equality. Also, in this category, I make this category the category of collection. A bit counterintuitive because I think as collection all sets in homotopy type theory, and the object of S will be projection of families of sets in the first universe, cioè dependent sets which are in the first universe. What are the key points? Thanks to the univalence axiom, of course I have extensionality of function to make the whole structure of the category because I take as equality the propositional equality. Thanks to extensionality of function, the category is Cartesian closed. And there is an omega classifier, which is the index sum of those propositions, the proposition in the first universe, which is a set, luckily, as proved in the book, oddity, and the propositional equality by univalence is given by any probability, so that it gives a classifier. Not just an intentional classifier, as in Martin Leaf type theory, but a classifier, which is very easy, very nice. And and there is a topo structure given as proved in the paper by Bass. And another thing to mention that you can see very quickly is that if you add a classical logic to the logic of collection, you get the topos, elementary topos, because the Boolean 1+1 will classify subset, all subset of collection. And but to be the more other example, I need an analog of the triple topos construction. But it's not available as such with the because the triple topos construction is the central notion when you build topos is that of functional relation. And it's not suitable for doing what I want. So I adopt the subcompletion of a finite limit category, treated, viewed as an elementary Cauchy completion to better compute with it.
The two completions are different, and we had a paper trying to know when they coincide, and they need, we need a choice principle, and actually a choice principle connected with the Hilbert operator to make the two constructions, which are very different, to be equivalent. And the elementary quotient completion was defined in a work with Pino Rosolini, and it is an extension of we try to extend the completion of to exact category on an X, of an X category to what? To generic doctrine. To generic doctrine. To we change the minimum to express the notion of equivalence relation. So the doctrine we equipped with just the conjunctive logic with the quality. By that we built a notion of completion like the setoid, more, more, you know, in time theory, where you have as object pairs, where you have an object given a doctrine, which is a functor of C, the base. You have an object pairs of an object of the base with an equivalence relation. Error are equivalence classes of base morphism which preserve the relation, and the whose equality is also given by the fact that two errors are seen equal by to send equal elements to equal elements of the codomain. And what is we build a completion which is not exact, which is regular. And it is exactly when the starting elementary doctrine is equivalent to the doctrine of X sub-objects. And so I have a characterization of X-lex completion in terms of doctrines. And I will use it to make in my example to compute, because computing with a pseudo-relation is difficult. But computing with the logic inside this doctrine is much better. And with this, I make a syntactic, I make an example out of Martin Luther theory, not univalent theory, not automotive theory, but Martin Luther theory. And I also consider, given the Martin Luther theory, only one universe. I built the category, the syntactic category out of Martin Luther theory, where objects are cross types, morphism terms, type terms, and the equality of between morphisms is propositional equality. The same way, but here we don't have a essential feature, so we cannot build directly the generalized elementary top. What we have to do? We have to make the exact lex completion. So we have to make the setoid model a bishop that, by using the machinery of elementary quotient completion, can be immediately recognized to be an exact lex completion of this category I defined before. And the object of S, of the family of sets, say on the collection, will be object in the arrow category, isomorphic over the codomain to projection of A index family of setoids, where A is the codomain, indicated with this notation, which are a notion defined already by Bishop and Richman. These are abstracting what? Internal action on you see the base, the index which you do the family of set, which is a setoid, let's say a support a set plus an equivalence relation, you view it as a groupoid, a possecal groupoid, and you build an action on it inside the ambient category. And what you get a dependent setoid, what is called a dependent setoid. And so it is a family of sets, equipped each values on each x as an equality, and you have substitute your isomorphism, which comes from the groupoid structure of the support, and which are proof irrelevant, so that you can speak about family of sets over a setoid, over a quotient, which is the right notion. And then, okay, and then you meet an example. And the last example is a predicative version of, sorry, the last example will be formalized in Pfefferman theory of non-iterative fixed point. This is a predicative theory which is classical, is an extension of arithmetics, Peano arithmetics, with non-necessary inductive list fixed points of positive arithmetical operator called defined by a so-called admissible formula. We did it. We just mimic the previous. We just mimic a model within ID1Net of Martin Luther theory with one universe. So we built with fixed point a universe of sets like that in Martin Luther theory, and we had then defined a notion of Molbor position as sets with the most which have most singleton. We are thinking of the weak subobject doctrine here. So categorically, we are making small proposition as those that come from the Posetta reflection of the notion of dependent sets, let's say. And what we do, we consider the category of recursive functions defined in ID1, in Fefferman theory of no iterative fixed point, whose objects are definable classes in the theory, so a subset of natural number defined by formula of the theory, and the morphisms are recursive functions denoted by numerals, and then we have as equality extension equality. By using this, we make our predicative generalized elementary topos, which has to be considered, we consider a predicative version of island effective topos. This is a joint work with Samuele Maschio, who is in the audience. And the category of collection will be, we cannot take the category of recursive maps and subset of natural numbers, but we do the exact less completion of it, view it as an elementary quotient completion, because we can calculate better, and then in the easier way. Objects of the category S, which I make an index here just to remember that this is a version of predicative effective topos, is the object of which has to be thought of a family of sets within the ambient category of collection, is the object which are isomorphic on the echo domain to projection of index family of object in the category, which are support is in the universe I defined before, in the universe here, yeah, which is intended to be a set, and whose equivalence relation is also small. So again, here the two sides play a role to get the category of sets. So it's the same thing. The interpretation here of the logical connectives and quantifier in the abiotic structure of the subobject doctrine of the predicative effective topos, let's say, or our predicative effective topos, is equivalent to clean realizability interpretation of intuitionistic logic. And we can embed the category inside island effective topos by knowing just categorically, basically. Because we know that the island effective topos is an exact or less completion of partition assemblies. Partition assemblies contain a full subcategory of a subset of natural number, a recursive function, you see, FC, but built into partition assemblies, and we just embed our category of subset of natural numbers in the arithmetic ID1Net and recursive function to it, and we get our embedding. And so I also have a definition of a generalized arithmetic, predicate generalized arithmetic quasi topos, but I skip, and I finish by saying that the next will be to build examples, more examples of this structure to prove consistency and conservativity results about the minimalist foundation, because by using topos technique, topos technique were used to prove result for CZF, for ICF, for intuitionistic predicative set theory, and then the next, of course, would be to define the notion of predicative shifts within this kind of, by taking as an underlying category of set that of a predicative generalized elementary topos. Thank you very much.